Hello, my friends. This is Brian, the speaker, coming to you today with a quick review of Ghostbusters Afterlife. Now, I had an opportunity to go see this with my entire family, because my entire family are huge fans of the Ghostbusters franchise, all the way down to my little five-year-old. She found out we were going to see Ghostbusters. She was not going to be left out of this. So she went and she loved it. She thought it was great. Watching it through her fingers because, Mom, is this going to be a scary part? And stuff. But she loves the original. So so we weren't torturing our daughter, I promise. But yeah, my whole family went, all eight of us. There's me and six of my wife and our six kids. Yes, I know I have a lot of kids. But this was a good movie. And it was a good family-friendly, fun film to go watch. Now, was this a great, flawless, perfectly executed film? No, it wasn't. But it was a good movie. Considering what we're getting right now, yeah, it was a good movie. And it's really kind of, it benefits from the low expectations that have been set by Hollywood. All things being equal, this would not be a fantastic film. Nobody would be like, this is the best Ghostbusters ever. I don't think anybody's saying that anyway. But the expectations for Hollywood have been set so low that this movie kind of benefits from that. I didn't feel like there was any woke agenda going on in this. I didn't feel like there was anything other than them just trying to make a decent film. I think Jason Reitman did as good as he could do with what he had. Now, my friend, Just Another Nerd, did a review of this, and he was absolutely brutal to this film. It made me laugh to watch it. So some of what I'm going to say is a little bit directed at some of the criticisms that he leveled, it's not to slap back at him or anything, because his concerns and his criticisms had some validity to them. Actually made me think about some things that I hadn't thought of. But in this movie, I gave them the benefit of the doubt. One, they were dealing with the death of Harold Ramis. They're suffering from something of like what happened in the Star Wars franchise, only all the actors were alive when that was started, and they could have done so much more than what they did with that franchise. Instead, they chose to bastardize it. And in lieu of what they did to Star Wars, I have to say, they at least treated the original cast with some dignity and some decency and tried to make everything work. But they were dealing with some issues there. So Harold Ramis had passed away like 10 years ago. He was not going to be able to be in this, you know, other than in ghost form. By the way, there will be spoilers. So if you have not seen Ghostbusters Afterlife, you might go away and come back when you've had the chance to go see this movie. Well, better late than never, huh? They were also dealing with the fact that Bill Murray is kind of a difficult person to work with right now. He's kind of notoriously known for being flighty and difficult to work with at times. There was a lot of questions. I remember when this movie was first brought up and that they were going to do this, whether they were even going to be able to get him to come and be a part of it. Cause he's hard to work with from everything I've heard, in Hollywood. So everybody was criticizing the fact that we only see the main cast really towards the very end of the film. I was okay with that because they're trying to establish something a little new, that they're trying to bring back to life the Ghostbusters franchise. And I think they want to do it in the most respectful way that they can while moving forward and doing something a little different. I loved the fact that this was set in a rural community out in the middle of nowhere. I thought it added to the kind of the overall scariness of this. Having grown up in a setting that was very much like this, very similar to this, I could identify with that. I've never lived in a city like New York. And I kept thinking throughout this, you know, that there are going to be a lot of people who can't identify with this. And some of the stuff that Just Another Nerd had problems with, I think stemmed from a misunderstanding of rural America. Now, there was some problems in the fact that it stems from Hollywood's misunderstanding of what we call flyover country. They don't really understand what goes on out across the fruited plain of this country. They don't. They live in cities. They live in New York, Los Angeles, Miami, wherever these huge cities are. So they really don't understand or get rural American life. And so a lot of this stems from the fact that they don't understand that. They don't understand that the fact that we have smartphones too. And they don't understand about the farming communities and what goes on there. And this idea that Hollywood thinks that everybody is just clamoring to get out of small communities to go to the big city. No, we're not. None of us really are, you know, a lot of us don't want to leave our small communities. We like our small communities, and we don't want to live in New York and Los Angeles and these giant crap holes that have been created by humanity. I know it's weird, right? Not all of us want to live where you live. And a lot of people are criticizing the love interest for the son in this. And I thought she was okay. She played a small town girl with a chip on her shoulder really well, I thought. A lot of people did not like her, did not like her performance, did not like anything about her. But I thought she was fairly believable in her character, because I've known girls just like that. They have a chip on their shoulder about who knows what. They're from a small town. Somebody comes to town and they're not very pleasant. But it's, you know, she kind of gets over that, and they, you know, it felt like a typical teenage romance. I felt like, what's his name? Wolford, his character did get underutilized a little bit. This movie suffered from trying to do a little too much in too short of time, and they didn't explain a lot of things that needed to be explained. Like Just Another Nerd said, where did this kid get his ability to work on engines to bring Ecto-1 back to life? You know, he gets a little bit of help from Egon, which I actually like that about this film. The fact that Egon is gone, but he's still in these kids' life, and he's still in his daughter's life, trying to help them out where he can. Which really goes to the character of Egon, that he sacrificed everything basically to try and save the world from Gozer again, because he knew Gozer wasn't really gone. That he figured out and found out that this was just going to happen again, and he went to try and stop it. A lot of people have criticized the fact that Ray didn't believe him, and that the other Ghostbusters didn't believe him and didn't help him and didn't follow him and didn't, you know, and he had to basically steal all the stuff and leave. And they're like, no, that would have never happened. Ray was his best friend. And then they, you know, then it never ended like that. If you don't understand an estrangement between friends, then you've never had that happen to you. I have. I had a best friend who was my cousin growing up, and we were best friends. I mean, we did like literally everything together. When we both got married and stuff, our families got together. We went camping. We have loads of memories of doing stuff for years and years and years together. And because of some certain things that happened, we became estranged, and I haven't hardly spoken to him in over 4 years. So friends can have a falling out. Friends can have something happen that makes you not believe them. And I brought this up on Loki's Mornings of Mischief stream about this movie, that Harold's character, Egon, wasn't always right and was a little flighty, even in the original film, because Venkman makes fun of him for trying to drill a hole in his head. And you know, and Egon's like, that would have worked if you hadn't stopped me. So, I mean, it plays into the fact that Egon can get a little extreme in his scientific views. And he wasn't always right, and he didn't always do the smartest thing. And stuff. So, I mean, he has that little bit of a character flaw that, I didn't feel like they did anything in this that was outside of the realm of what had been established for these characters. They just didn't explain it very well. This film definitely suffers from that problem. An under explanation of how the characters got to where they are now. Why they have the skills and abilities that they do. You're just kind of expected to just buy in. And I did, for the most part. For the most part, I was just like, okay, I get it. You're trying to make a film that covers a 30-year history span. And you're trying to do it in a relatively short amount of time. You're trying to introduce these new characters while still paying homage to the original cast. I just think that he should have taken a little bit more time and explained how people got to where they are. Why Janine is still involved with Egon, but only in kind of a fleeting, peripheral way. Why the mother, Egon's spouse or love interest or whatever that he had these two kids with, or that he had a daughter with, where is she? Why isn't she in the picture? And the mother in this, I thought it was interesting that they actually portrayed a woman as a flawed character. Something that Hollywood isn't doing right now. She's not a good mother. She is a horrendous mother. Really a horrendous person who is just falling apart at the seams at every turn. And we don't see that a lot from Hollywood right now. A lot of times we see Hollywood as the dads are the worthless, nobody, nothings, and the moms are these heroic, wonderful characters that just, oh. And we didn't get that. We got a flawed, tragic mother who used her father's, what she considered abandonment, to basically destroy her own life. Her perceptions of about her husband who left because he couldn't understand Phoebe. Just Another Nerd kind of brought that up as well. And I saw that as just another character flaw of the mother. That probably wasn't really the reason, but that's the reason she convinced herself that that the husband or the father of these two kids of hers had left and walked out. Because she wouldn't deal with the real reality that she was bad with money, she didn't work, she was kind of a loser, that she had daddy issues. I mean, that probably all played into the fact that their marriage or their couple court, whatever people call it anymore, because, you know, how many people actually get married now? I mean, really, what an old-fashioned concept. But let's just say for the sake they were married. I mean, that could have been the reason for the end of their marriage. She had some serious daddy issues. And so she, you know, people tend to make things happen to themselves that they don't want to happen, but that they perceive it's going to happen anyway, and they'll make it happen in their life, you know, cause another man to abandon them by being an absolute cow to him and then blaming him for it. And who knows? But I mean, that's what I mean. Jason didn't explain any of that through his script and through. So there was a lot of unknowns, a lot of story that needed to be part of this movie that wasn't. Way too much was left unexplained, and so I wish that he would have done more to kind of catch us up to where we are in the history of these characters. It would have one, made the audience identify a lot more with these characters, to be able to understand their motivations and stuff. Every time I think about that, I don't know if you guys remember the old Sprite commercial from the 90s. There's these three black guys that are playing basketball, and they come up to the camera, and they're all like, they're all kind of standing there together, all posing, and he's like, if you want to be great in sports, drink Turbo Sports 7. From, you know, the other side of the camera, you hear the director or somebody say, the can's upside down, genius. And the guy and the black guy's like, don't talk to me like that. I played Hamlet at Cambridge. And the other black guy's just like, he's like making all these hand gestures like he's having a fit. And then the really like hard looking black guy off the side, he's shaved head, he's like, hey, what's my motivation? What's my motivation? It's one of the funniest commercials I ever saw. And I apologize for introducing that into this. But every time I think of when I don't understand the motivations of a character because they weren't made clear in a film, I think about that commercial. What's my motivation? You know, and I just sit there and it's hard to identify with the character when they didn't have clear motivations, when you don't understand where they're coming from. You just kind of stand back and go, okay. And you just kind of have to accept it, and you either do or you don't. And it makes it hard to buy into the premise of the film. But overall, it was just a fun film. Did all of it make sense? No. Did the Stay Puft Marshmallow Men make sense? No, but gosh damn, they were hilarious. I don't even care if it was just done to sell little plushy Stay Puft Marshmallow toys. I thought it was hilarious, and it was a fun little callback to the original film. And it was fun. I mean, it was, to me, it was the same kind of thing as when in the original film, the eggs pop out and start frying on the counter, with Dana and stuff like that. It's meant to be creepy and scary, but also kind of a, you know, and I felt this really kind of called back so much of the original film. Every time that music played, I just got tingles. And it was so much fun to feel like they were trying to be respectful while also doing something a little new and different. And this is how you do that. Yeah, sure, they played on the member berries. They absolutely did. But they did it in what I felt like was an honest and respectful way. They were trying to pay homage to a great film of the 80s. They were trying to connect those two worlds, even though there'd been 30 years between the movies. And they did it the best way they could. Did they do it all right? No, not even close. But Podcast, I thought, was a great character. He was a lot of fun. That's not really his name. That's just what he called himself. And a lot of people are like, his name's not Podcast. Yeah, it wasn't. And I loved the fact that he was using this old, old equipment to run his podcast, because if you've ever been around somebody who's a true audiophile or whatever, they love that kind of stuff. They love old equipment. They love, all of that stuff, the vintage equipment and things like that. And I love the fact that they kind of made him that character who's got the big long microphone and the, you know, and stuff. I thought it was a fun callback to some of the stuff that they'd used in the 80s film. And poor rural Americans still use stuff like that. Not nearly like they used to. Yes, we do have smartphones, and I have a smartphone. Actually, I'm filming this on a smartphone. But I get that, but that's just a misunderstanding of city people to rural people. And you definitely get that in this, you know, but it was fun to see some of that stuff. So I hope if they do move forward with this franchise, I hope that they continue to try and be respectful. But if they do continue on, I really hope that they take the time to explain the backstory, to bring up the facts and fill in the gaps of what they didn't do in this film. What happened to Egon's wife, lover, baby mama, whatever she was. Who was it? Was it the lab partner that we saw in Ghostbusters 2? I doubt it, because she was Asian. But that would have shown in the mother of the two kids of this. But it would have been nice to have some of those gaps filled in. And to have a little bit more explained about the estrangement between Egon and the rest of the Ghostbusters. I think a lot of that was probably due to the fact that they couldn't get Bill Murray to do too awfully much in this film. So they had to kind of, just string that together because he was only willing to do so much. Now, I don't know that for a fact, but I know that they had a hell of a time even getting him to come and commit to be a part of this film. Right up into the filming, they weren't sure whether he was actually coming or not. So who knows what went on behind the scenes, and what Jason Reitman had to deal with to even get this movie to happen the way it did. And the thing I think we really need to remember about this movie is it didn't have a large budget. This was not a $300 million film. This was a, you know, this was a film done on what would have been a shoestring budget, you know. And so I think he did the best that he could. And I think it looked great for what it was. Gozer didn't really look that great. We missed out on seeing her become the destroyer again. She just stays herself this time. And maybe she did that because she didn't want to give them the opportunity to try and take her out the same way again. Who knows? I don't know. But I loved seeing the Shandor mining company at the beginning. I was just like, oh yeah, they're tying this all back together. And it was fun to see them end that story that they'd begun. And a lot of people are upset that they used the same villain again. I'm not necessarily angry that they used the same villain again. I hope this is the last time we see Gozer, and that, you know, that storyline is completed in this one. And that they move on from there, and that they do some different things and go down some different roads. But I felt like this was all just kind of wrapping up the original Ghostbusters saga, that this was the end of their part of the story. And we may see them pop in and out of the later films if they do another film, but from what I'm hearing, Sony's already greenlit another film. So that this movie has done well enough that they're going to move it forward. Now, I think Just Another Nerd is right. I think a lot of this movie may have been done by committee, but I think Jason Reitman did as much as he could to make it his and not, you know, Sony's movie. But we'll see. Hopefully this gets better. Hopefully they do more in the next films, and that they stay somewhat on track for making these characters good. I thought really the characters of the film were decent for the most part. Podcast, Phoebe, the Wolford kid, I can never remember his name in the movie, but I liked the little girl's character. I found her very funny. I found her very deadpan. I found her very Egon-esque, and I liked that about her. I liked the fact that they made her a lot like Egon. And not necessarily a female knockoff of Egon, but that she gets Egon. One of my favorite parts of the film, and this is where I'll end this, is when she's down in the cellar, where Egon does most of his work, and she's trying to fix the proton pack. And Egon is helping her. She's like, how did you get this so small? And the light flips over to the diploma on the wall, and she's like, all right. I thought that was fantastic. I mean, taking a light, like, you know, just the regular light, you know, fixture, and basically giving it life, and using that to stand in for Egon. You get the overall tone of what he's trying to say through a light fixture. And I thought that was great. I thought that was very clever and very, you know, interesting. And I love the dad jokes that she tells as the little girl. Those were just laugh out loud, funny moments to me, because she just tells them so well. It just deadpans the whole thing, you know, and just, anyway, so this movie had some really cute and fun moments. And overall, as a family movie, my family loved it. And that's something I haven't felt or seen in my family for a long time. And that makes this movie worth it to me. That we walked out laughing and talking and having had a fun time at a movie, not walking out wanting to throw my soft drink at the screen. Because that doesn't happen that much anymore. I was so excited for the new Dune film. and then felt let down by it. It wasn't a horrible film, but it wasn't great either. This one did not leave me with that vibe. I felt like it was as good as we were going to get, given the era that we live in. And maybe that's a cop-out to give it that much, but I just felt like this movie had some fun moments to it. Anyway, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this review. Go watch this movie and let me know what you think about it. Tell me, did you like it? What didn't you like about it? Did you feel like this? Go watch Just Another Nerd's review of this, because he really goes into depth on some of the things that he did not like about it. And it's valid. There are some really valid points for why this movie had a lot of stuff wrong with it. And I don't know whether it was just because I went with my kids and I saw their enjoyment of it that I was able to overlook quite a bit of that. And maybe the nostalgia blinded me to some of the problems this film had. But different perspectives on this film is always good. It's never good to be just a shill and just buy in, you know, to everything willy-nilly. Anyway, thanks for watching, and we'll talk to you next time. Bye now.